Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome as we come together to worship and to celebrate this fine morning. Hopefully, God's been blessing you throughout the week, that you've been growing close to Him, been working in your life and through your life, and you're ready to come and to celebrate, to lift yourselves up as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing, in worship and praise and adoration. Isn't it good to know that God is with us yesterday, today, and forever, for He is the everlasting God. And He will give us strength, He'll give us hope, He gives us everything we need. Let's stand together as we worship Him this morning, for He is the everlasting God.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Rises, we wait upon the Lord.
God is with us. He's watching over us. He's taking care of us wherever we may be. We are so glad that you are with us this morning as we worship and celebrate together. You may be seated. We also want to welcome those who are joining us on Facebook Live. As we come together, we pray that God would be with you, that He'll watch over you and bless you right where you are at. We are glad that you are here this morning, and we want to lift up opportunities to how you can be involved in ministry in our church. One is that Pastor Tara is looking for those who want to help out with our jam time. Our jam time is starting back up. That's our Wednesday evening, midweek, children's worship and growth time. And that starts this on February 3rd. And she needs helpers. She needs people who will be table mates. That's people who will sit with the kids while they're eating the dinner that we provide, to just interact with them, to ask, talk to them and let them know that they're cared about. She's looking for teachers. She's looking for people who are willing to prepare a meal. She's looking for once a month, but if we get enough people, it may not be that often, that if you're willing to prepare a meal for it. Helpers and greeters. And if you're unable to come out or uncomfortable coming out of that, prayers. We need people to pray for this, that God will continue to work and move. And so in whatever area that God is leading you that you can be involved, we want to invite you, please, let Pastor Tara know at what capacity you want to be involved in helping out with our midweek jam time. All right. Pat, you want to share with us?
I wanted to announce that next Sunday, right after church, is a ministry leaders meeting. It's a quarterly meeting. So if you are one of those ministry leaders of Ladies Fellowship, Men's Ministry, Care and Compassion, Cornerstone, whatever it might be, we'll be meeting in the fellowship hall right after church next Sunday. Lunch will be provided. If you're a leader and you can't be there, please appoint someone from your team to be there. And also, we'll be putting together a calendar, just a outline calendar of events that happen annually at PayNAS. So bring those with you. And if you're in the congregation and you think of something that needs to be put on there, please let us know. So again, next Sunday, immediately after church.
Good morning. I just want to thank everybody that was here yesterday as we decluttered the church and did some carpet cleaning. If your chair is wet, I assume you've moved by now. We did some upholstery cleaning. I just want to thank everybody for their work yesterday. We really did a decluttered job. And so out in the foyer on the table are some things that are real treasures, and I would really encourage you to take a load home so Wayne doesn't have to do anything with it. There's a couple screens out there. Those things work. There's a big coffee maker. It works. And so anything that is not out of here today will be out of here this week, either to the youth ranch or to the dump or whatever. I just want to thank everybody.
Thank you. All right, other opportunities we have to get involved, to join in. Also next Sunday, if you're interested in finding out more about Payette Church of the Nazarene or you're interested in membership, I'm doing a membership class from 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock next Sunday in the Fellowship Hall. For anyone who is interested in doing that, if you want, please talk to me if you're interested. That way I can make sure I have enough materials for everybody. All right. Then also, Valentine's Day is coming up, and so if we're going to be having a Valentine's dinner on February 13th. Tickets are $10 per person, and we're just looking forward to coming together, celebrating together, and if you're interested, talk to Pam Gertis or some others there. We'll be getting you more information as we go along. Also want to let you know that we are still collecting shoes. There's a shoe bin out there, so if you have new or gently used shoes that you'd like to bring in, we're collecting those. They go in, they get distributed to people who need them, and then we get money to help out with a mission trip that we're going to be taking. Although the timing on that mission trip is changing, as we got information recently that we're probably not going to be able to go this year with COVID and with changes in pastoral leadership at the church we're planning on going to. But we know that God has perfect timing, and we will be going eventually, so we're still collecting for that. All right, so please be praying. Also want to let you know, Pam and I have a special request from everybody, and we've been talking with the church stewards on this, about what we want to do. But this year, Pam and I both celebrate our 50th birthdays, so we both turned 50 this year, and As part of that, a lot of times at birthday time, they ask for cards and gifts and stuff like that. But what we would really like from people in celebrating our 50th birthdays is if we could get 50 people to take 50 days through the year to pray and fast for us, for God's will, for His desire. We have some specific things to do, but then also as God lays it on your heart. And so our stewards, I think Adele is heading this up, are going to be putting together a calendar of this year and asking for people to sign up to say, I'll take this day to pray. We are so appreciative of that. We need that for God to be watching over our lives and blessing us. He's been doing amazing things in our lives recently, and we're looking forward to what He's going to do in the future. And so we'd ask, if you want to honor us and the fact that we're turning 50, if you would sign up and join in. If more than 50 sign up, that's even better. Okay, we'll celebrate, we won't celebrate however many years people sign up. But we'd love to have you pray for us, and we appreciate you. We know you pray for us already, but it'd just be wonderful to have that, and what a great way to be honored and blessed through this. All right. Well, God is doing amazing things, and we are glad to be able to come and to worship together. And just want to remind you that also coming up is our wild game feed. Jim, you want to tell us about that?
Yes, thank you, Pastor. So February 6th, 2 weeks to go, we still have tickets available. Or if you're interested in bringing an item to the dinner to contribute to that, or contribute an item for our silent auction, see me to sign up for that. If you would like to take flyers to your work and put those out, I've got some available. And if you have, for the guys especially, if you have an unchurched friend, somebody who's maybe searching, this is a fantastic opportunity to bring them to an event and maybe expose them to a different way of quote unquote doing church. And so if you're interested, maybe think about somebody that you've got, a friend, relative, coworker, and buy them a ticket and bring them along. They will be blessed, and so will you. So thank you.
All right. Yes, definitely looking forward to that. Then there's a couple more things. One is, don't forget, in the month of January, we are collecting things for the Hope Pregnancy Center over in Ontario. There's a list of items in your bulletin of what they're looking for that we can help out with them. And also one other way that we can reach out and share God's love, Dino Rodriguez, this is Christina Borwick's son, has joined the Navy. He's off at training, but his birthday is coming up February 21st. And Christina said, hey, it would be really great, not just for his birthday, but other times, if people would send him cards or letters or pictures saying, hey, we're thinking of you, we're praying for you. Dino came up in our children's and our youth department as well, and so we'd love to continue to support him. They do ask no packages and nothing with glitter on it. So, but I was told plenty of perfume is fine. Okay, so... but no, but we want to just reach out to Dino and let him know that his church family loves him and cares about him. And so if you want to send him a letter or something, his address is here in the bulletin there, and you can send those things out. All right. Well, we are here to worship and to celebrate. God is doing amazing things. He continues to work in and through our lives in amazing ways, and we can look forward to what he's doing. In Luke chapter 7, verses 18 to 23, we read this. Let's read this together. Let's stand together as and read this. All right. The disciples of John reported all these things to him. And John, calling two of his disciples to him, sent them to the Lord, saying, are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another? And when the men had come to him, they said, John the Baptist has sent us to you, saying, are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another? In that hour he healed many people of diseases and plagues and evil spirits, and on many who were blind he bestowed sight. And he answered them, go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, the poor have good news preached to them, and blessed is the one who is not offended by me. You know, John the Baptist has been arrested, he's in jail. I think he kind of had, the setting kind of sets this, that he almost expected Jesus to deliver him. And when Jesus doesn't, he begins to question, are you truly the one? Are you truly one, or do you care? How many of you have ever been in that place where you've wondered, God, do you really care? I don't see your hand at work. I'm not seeing you here. Are you really present? Are you really with me? I think a lot of us have experienced that, especially during this last year and even into this year. God, are you really at work? And Jesus' answer is, just look around you. Just look around. You'll see my hand at work. You know that I am with you. I promise you I am at work, and I am moving, and I am working. And you will be blessed if you just keep trusting. Keep trusting. And we are blessed, for in trusting in Him and continuing to follow Him, we have hope. We have peace. We even have joy. We have life. Why? Because Jesus lives. And He not only lives, but He lives inside of us. And we have a life worth living because of Him. Amen? Amen.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds a future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy He gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because He lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds a future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. And then one day I'll cross that river. I'll find my son, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lines of glory, and I'll know He lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know and life is worth the living just because He lives. And life is worth the living just because He lives. We stand and lift our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing. Everyone sing. Glory, glory is the Lord God Almighty. and lift up our hands. For the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. And together we sing. Everyone sing.
God, that is so true. Your word tells us that creation cries out your praise and your glory. And all we have to do is look around us and we will see your hand at work and know that you are there. And so God, we pray that you would help us to seek you. You'd help us to have our eyes open, that we would see you, that we would trust you, that we'd follow you. And live as the people you created us to live, because we're being the people you created us to be. And so, God, we pray you teach us today through your word that what your truth is, that you would help us, God, by your Spirit, to apply that word to our lives on a daily basis. As you lead us, as you enable us, as you empower us in your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, if you have your Bibles today, we invite you to turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 through 8. We're on a journey together in a thing of stewardship, of how can we be godly stewards. And as Pastor Johnny and I were talking with each other about this, we started thinking, you know, stewardship is kind of a word that gets people kind of uptight, because usually when you start talking about stewardship, everybody goes, oh, you're talking about money again. You want our money. That's all the church ever does, is ask for money. And the fact is that godly stewardship is about so much more than money. In fact, the reality is money is just a very, very small part of what God is desiring for us. And so as Pastor Johnny and I were talking about, we thought, well, what's a way that we can illustrate this, that people in Idaho or Oregon can understand? And we started thinking, we said, I know what. How about irrigation? We understand irrigation around here, right? You got to get the water from a source onto a field, right? Or water from a source onto our yards, or somehow we get an idea of what irrigation is. And that's really a picture of what stewardship is, isn't it? You have a source, a well, a river, a pond, or a lake, or something that is the source of that water. And somehow we want to get it out onto a yard or into a field. And so we have to get a pump, we have to get pipes, we have to get different things involved in order to do that. And so in godly stewardship, what do we find? We find that we have a source, and that is our God. God is a source for every good and perfect gift that we have. Every need that gets met, everything that's good in our lives has been sourced by God. He is that source. In fact, God is life himself. And he is the giver. He's not only creator of life, he's the giver of life. He is life. And so if we're going to see that life get out into the world, if we're going to see it get to other people and other places, after all, what did Jesus teach? He said about the kingdom of God. He said the kingdom of God is like a farmer who goes out into the field and scatters seed, right? The word there is a word we have today is broadcast. It just goes out everywhere. And they had a way they just grab the seed and fling it. And it, wherever it landed, it landed. And he said, and in those fields, you know, some of it landed in rocky soil. Some of it landed on the hard pack. Some landed in weedy soil. And some landed on fertile soil. But as we know around here, even if it lands on fertile soil, it still requires what? Water. Water. So how do we get the water from the source to there? Well, we need conduits. We need pipes. We need sprinklers. We need whatever we may think of to get it there. Guess what? We are the conduits. That is stewardship. It's an irrigating. It's getting stuff from the source who is God to the people who need it in order to live. Wherever it needs to go in order to bring life, in order to bring godliness, in order to bring hope, in order to bring peace, in order to get the blessings of God out to the people who need it. That's stewardship. Stewardship is getting the resources to where they're needed. And so today we're here, and in 2 Corinthians 8, verse 5, as Pastor Johnny shared with us last week, we find that the way that we can be these stewards, the biblical model of what stewardship, godly stewardship looks like, comes from where Paul talks about this church in Macedonia. And they're giving a gift, they're giving even though they're needy themselves, but he says, here's why they're able to do this. He says, they went beyond anything we imagined. Why? Because they first gave themselves to God, and then to us as God led them. Okay? So in being godly stewards, we need to first give ourselves to God, and then as God leads us, give to others. And when we do that, we'll find ourselves having an easier time of being these godly stewards and living the way God wants us to. Now, like I said, when we start talking about stewardship, when we talk about this irrigation or whatever, it's important that we remember that it is not just about money. But there are so many areas that God wants us to be godly stewards of. There's so many areas where God says, I want to work through you and I've blessed you with these things in order that you may then, that I may then work through you in a way that will bless others and will bring honor and glory to God. And this morning, as we're in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8, as we're reading these words from Solomon, we're going to learn about this first area that we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about different areas over these next few weeks. But this first area of how can I be a godly steward of my time? Of my time. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, 1 through 8, Solomon writes these things. He says, there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. And Solomon in this, he's telling us, hey, we all have time, right? We all are given time. In fact, the Bible teaches that God created time for us. And that part of us having the best life possible is to live within this time that God has given to us. See, God is eternal. He is not controlled. He is not within the boundaries of time. He's outside of time. And so he sees past, present, and future as right now. But he realized that if he did that to us, then that would be overwhelming to us. Because we are physical beings. He's a spiritual being. And in our physical bodies, if we did not have time, if we did not have set rhythms and things, then we would just become overwhelmed. And so God created time, and he put it in place because he knew that was what was best for us. And the way that we can be the best and be the people he created us to be. But then he turns around and says, but guess what? Time is a gift from God. Therefore, we need to be godly stewards of our time. We need to say, okay, God, if you, how can we best help others? How can we see your life come to us and be spread through us to others in this area of time? How do you want to use time to do this? Well, Solomon comes in and says, first of all, we need to realize that, you know, everybody has time. Did you know we all have 24 hours a day? God didn't take some and say, well, you only get 20 hours and you get 28, right? But he said, we have time and we all have the same amount of time. Therefore, if we're going to be godly stewards of our time, it's not about how we're going to use the time. It's not even about, but it's what are we going to make time for? What are we going to make time for? I don't know about you, but I've learned in my life and in the lives of the people I've talked to, we all talk about we don't have enough time, right? Anybody here ever found yourself saying, wow, I don't have enough time to do everything I really would like to do? And it seems like about the time that we get to the place that we're going, hey, we're finally getting a handle on this, something else comes up. There's one more thing, there's one more meeting, there's one more this, there's one more that is vying for our time. But what I've realized is in the midst of this, in the midst of all these things clamoring for our time, we still have time for those things that are important to us. Why? Because we don't just have time, we make time for them. For those things that are important, for those things that we value in our lives, we will make time for them. And so what I came to the realization of is if we want to be godly stewards of our time, if we want to use that time or invest that time in a way that brings honor and glory to God and helps bring life to the people around us and the situation around us, as God gives us, as God enables us, then there are certain things we must make time for. The first thing we need to make time for is we need to make time for God. Make time for God. Now, I have to admit, as soon as I wrote that, I cringed. Because I don't like that phrase. Not because God shouldn't have time or more time, but because if you really think about what the Bible teaches us, the Bible teaches God is with us all the time. And that every moment should be for God. That he literally lives within us through his Spirit. And so he's with us every moment. And so this idea of make time for God is like, well, of course, that should be all the time. But then as I begin to read and I begin to study and I begin to think about like the life of Jesus and other leaders in the church and heroes of our faith that we look at, we find that not only did they allow God to have control in their lives in the entirety and live for him every moment, but as we read in Mark 1, verse 35, Jesus has been out, he's been ministering, he's been healing, he's even been casting out demons, it says. But when we get to Mark 1:35, it says, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. And as I've shared before, when we were talking about prayer and stuff, this word for prayed is he simply went to spend time with God in order to grow in relationship and to be close to him. It wasn't about requests. It was simply went and spent time. He was making time for his Father just to hang out together. All right? Why is that? It's because even in the midst of allowing God to work in our lives and through our lives at all times as he's called us to, there's a realization that when we are out with people, when we are out around people and we are going through our daily lives, it's really hard to stop and say, okay, God, how do we connect? How can we be intimate and close to each other? When you're in the midst of your work day or in the clamoring of everything coming, it's hard to hear that still small voice that is God speaking to us and God guiding and directing. And so it's important that we make time to go, okay, God, my only focus, my only intent here is you. Is you. Just to be with you and grow closer to you. And we find that Jesus did that. And I'll tell you this, if Jesus as the Son of God, if Jesus as God in the flesh needed that, how much more do we need that? How much more important is it that we would realize our need to simply spend time with God? Make time to just be with Him, to listen to Him, to grow closer to Him, to develop in our relationship with Him. In Psalm 5, verse 3, the psalmist writes this. He says, in the morning, Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you and wait expectantly. He simply comes and says, I'm just coming to be with you. And I understand, and in growing up in the church and stuff, I kept hearing people say, well, see, Jesus got up in the morning. We need to get up in the morning. See, Jesus did that. See, the psalmist writes about getting up in the morning. So if we're going to spend time, we need to do that in the morning. Make it the first thing in your day. You know, I came to the realization, some of us are not morning people. And to go, you know, some of us don't even realize 5 o'clock comes twice in the same day. Right? And I used to feel really guilty about this whole thing of, well, I didn't get up at 5 and I didn't do this and you know, and that's what was really being pushed and stuff. But then I began to read and some of the things of Christian people and people who were pillars in the church and pillars in the kingdom of God. And I found out, you know, John Wesley and Charles Wesley, who are the founders of Methodism and stuff, their mom, Susanna, her time with God was in the middle of the day. She'd be in the kitchen. She had like 10 or 12 kids. And in the middle of the day in the kitchen, she would take her apron and throw it up over her head and spend time in prayer. And the kids knew if mom's apron's over her head, don't bug her. Why? Because she's spending quiet time with her. And that was in the middle of the day. Other people, I was reading and found that their best time was in the evening when they'd have their opportunity to. And so what I began to realize was it's not about what time it is that you make this time. What's important is that we make time. And it doesn't do any good to make time with God if you're sleeping through it. And you're not listening to Him. And God is not a God who says, well, it has to be at this time. It's not like God only shows up at 5 in the morning. He shows up whenever we make time to be with Him. He's there. And so I would encourage you to find those times where you go, listen, I want to make time for God. Not that He's not with me all the time, but for these special times to really get close to Him, to listen to Him, because God has a purpose and a plan. It's interesting that when you see these times that Jesus gets away, it's after these times that He gets away where you see Him praying all night or whatever, that He comes back. And one of these times he comes back and he's had a lot of disciples who are following him, but when he comes back, he appoints 12 as apostles out of the disciples. Where'd that come from? His time with the Father. God, in their conversation, they said, these are the ones we're going to set aside for what we're doing here. There's often times where he comes back from being all night and he comes back and he says, okay, guys, now we're going this direction. And they start off in this ministry of and things that they are doing. It's interesting that it that it's after praying and after his time with God that Jesus walks on the water out to the disciples and is able to call Peter as well. And so what do we find? We find that these are special, intimate. If we are going to be the kind of, if we're going to be the irrigation system, how many of you have ever had a time where you know the water's supposed to turn on, it's not turning on, or maybe you went out and you had in your home and your water system, you flipped a switch or something, and it was supposed to turn on, it's supposed to go, and nothing happened. Oh yeah, everything's connected. The power's all there. You ever gone back and looked and found out, oh, the hose isn't connected to the spigot? See, if we're not connected to the source, we'll never get the water to where it needs to go. If we're not connected to God, we will never get the provision of God from where it is to where it needs to go. We have to be connected to him. So we must make time for God. The next area where we need to make time for is you need to make time for yourself. You need to make time for yourself. And now I know we're in church and in growing up, so often we come around the church and you get around people, it's like, no, can't make time for yourself. It shouldn't be about yourself. That's selfish. That's being selfish. It needs to be all about others, all this stuff. But here's the reality. Jesus went to the disciples when they said, hey, let's talk about love. He says, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And he says, love your neighbor as yourself. In other words, if you're not loving yourself, if you're not taking care of yourself, guess what? You're not going to be able to love your neighbor or take care of your neighbor. After all, how many of you have ever had a time where you went, oh man, I'm really thirsty, and you reached for a pitcher and went to pour it, and it was empty? How good did that do at quenching your thirst? Not at all, huh? And in the same way, as we seek to help others, as we seek to reach out to others, as we seek to say, okay, God, we want you to work within us and through us. We want to be these conduits and see your blessings get to the people around us. It's not going to happen if we aren't allowing God to fill us up. And if we're not taking care of ourselves. After all, how many of you ever had a time when you went to turn the sprinkler on and you turned it on and the hose blew out? Or there was holes in the hose. Dog chewed it. Something happened. And you saw this water pouring out everywhere and you went to look at your sprinkler and there's like maybe a trickle coming out, right? Why? Because we didn't take care of the hose. Didn't take care of the pipe that was needed to get there. Water does not get from the source to where it needs to go in irrigation unless the hoses or the pipes or the things in between are taken care of and maintained. In the same way, the blessings of God will not get from him to the people that need to through us if we don't take care of ourselves. And we need to take care of ourselves in many different ways. First, we need to take care of ourselves spiritually. We need to make sure that we are right with God and we are living in right relationship with God and that we are growing in that relationship with God. And the psalmist tells us how we can do that. In Psalm 1, I don't think it's by accident that this is the first one here because it is the bedrock of where everything else comes from. But it says, blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked or stand in the way that sinners take or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord and who meditates on his law day and night. Listen to this. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. There's that person becomes like a tree that is constantly sourced. And because of that, fruit is coming out. The water is flowing through. The nutrients are flowing through, getting to where it needs to be in order to produce fruit. In the same way, Jesus tells us in, in John 15:5, I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Nothing. In other words, if we're not connected to him, and if we're not growing, if we're not healthy, then nothing will happen. Ever tried to get fruit from a dead branch? Why? Because we know it's not going to happen, right? In the same way, if we do not take care of ourselves as these branches, as these pipes, as these hoses, whatever, as these conduits of God's grace and of God's blessing, then they're not going to get through us. Produce the fruit, do these things. And so we need to do this spiritually. But it's not just spiritually. We need to take care of ourselves physically, emotionally, mentally, relationally. We need to take care of ourselves. I can't tell you how many times, I mean, Pam and I have been doing this new eating diet, and it's not for everybody, but for us, one of the things we looked at is we said we started it to lose weight, and that started working well, and now it's kind of all plateaued off, but we're still sticking with it. Why? Because we've noticed the difference in our energy, in our attitudes, and in our just our thinking capacity that comes from eating healthy, from getting enough water. Okay, it affects us. And you can go and you can study, and I would challenge you to take the time and go, hey, let's do an experiment. Let's try eating healthy foods for a week or two and see how we feel at the end of it. Then let's reintroduce all the junk we normally eat and see how we feel. Pam and I have learned it makes a profound difference. The foods we choose to eat affects us in all these ways. All right? And so I would encourage you. I'm not promoting any particular diet or anything, but it's a reality. So I'd encourage you to check that out and see if we can do that. Physically, that means, you know, we need to get the rest that we need and the sleep that we need in order to grow and in order to develop. I run into people, well, I need to do more, I need to do more, I need to do more. Guess what? God said we need to rest as well. In fact, he designed it and said we need a Sabbath day, a day of rest. He not only designed us that way, he designed all of creation that way for a Sabbath rest. And yet at times we seem to think like, well, we know better than you, God. We'll just keep going, keep going, keep going. To which we get the saying, I don't know who said it, but they said, he who burns the candle at both ends is not as bright as he thinks. Okay. We need to understand that. We need this. We need to take care of ourselves physically. We need to get the help that we need emotionally, mentally, okay? Relationally, we need to be healthy in these areas, which means that if we find ourselves hurting or deficient in them, it's okay to seek help from others. It's okay. Get counseling. Look to the experts, read up on it, find ways to get the help that you need in order to be healthy. Take care of yourself, because if you don't take care of yourself, you're never going to be able to help others. You cannot pour from an empty vessel. It just doesn't work. And in case you're here going, oh, well, how I treat myself or what I do for myself doesn't affect anybody else. Don't forget all the teaching throughout the Bible that we are all part of a bigger body, right? It's not just about you. And to say, well, what happens to me doesn't affect anything else. Stop for a moment. How many of you ever had those times where you like take a string and wrap it around your finger really tight, cut off the blood flow? Anybody ever do that? Yeah, you were never kids, huh? Did you notice that as your finger turned purple, it didn't just affect your finger, the rest of your body seemed to feel it too? Or as I've shared before, if you've been walking through your house at night and found out what your toes were for, finding furniture in the dark, you notice when you stubbed your toes, it wasn't just your toe that hurt, it was like your whole body hurt. Or how about when you had your kids and you're holding them and you're playing, oh, isn't this fun? And all of a sudden they stick their finger in your eye. You notice it wasn't just your eye that said, ow. Your whole body reacted, huh? Why? Because they're all connected. It's all connected together. God designed our bodies to all be connected in the same way his body is all connected. And we are all part of the body. And how we choose to live our lives and how we choose to act and take care of ourselves affects the rest of the body. In the same way, what's going on in the rest of the body also affects us. Even if we seem to be disconnected, things that happen around us, whether it's in the body of Christ or just in humanity in general, will affect us. I've been getting a big education in this as I've been reading different books and talking with different people. Did you know that human trafficking going on in India or throughout the U.S. affects us, even though we may think, wow, in Payette, Idaho, we don't really have that problem? If it's happening to humanity, it affects us and it affects you. Racism, that we tend to say, well, that's somewhere else, right? Doesn't matter where it's at. It affects us, and it will affect you. Why? Because we are a body and we are connected. And when one part gets torn down, the whole body gets torn down. When one is built up, the whole body gets built up. When we see fighting over politics, you know, out there, that would never happen here, I understand that. But out there somewhere, and we can go, oh, well, that's out there, it still affects us here. When our brothers and sisters in Africa and in Asia and in different areas are persecuted because of their faith, guess what? It affects us. We're one body. And so we need to understand that. See, in America, we've become way too individualistic, even in the church. It's all about me. It's all about my relationship with God. But we are part of a body, and what happens to others affects us, which is why the Word of God tells us to rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. Why? Because it affects us, or at least it should. And if it doesn't affect us, it's because we've cut ourselves off from the body. And just like if you took any part of your body and cut it off, is it going to thrive? No, it's going to die, right? If we choose to cut ourselves off from the rest of the body, guess what happens to us? We die. We die. And so we need to understand how we treat ourselves, what we do, and how we live affects the entire body. And what goes on in the body affects us. And so we need to take care of ourselves. And we need to make time for doing it. So how can I be a godly steward of my time? Number one, make time for God. Number two, make time for yourself. And then make time for others. Make time for others. In other words, we are here to be conduits, right? It's not just about us. If you take water and take it from the source and then you put it into a barrel and you leave it there, guess what happens? It's really gross. Sludge, moss, things grow, animals die in it, and it becomes poisonous. Toxic. But when you take one and you pour into it and you have holes in it that allow the water to flow out, or you have pipes or things that flow out and go out, then it stays fresh, then it stays clean, then it stays pure, and it continues to be life-giving. And so we need to understand that God does not pour blessings into us in order for us to keep them to ourselves, but in order that he can work through us to bless others. But we need to make time for others. We need to make time. We need to make time to build relationships, to actually get to know people. You know, there used to be a day, and I remember those days when everybody was like out on their front porch. How many houses do we see being built today that even have a front porch? We've gotten rid of our front porches and fenced in our backyards. We have automatic garage doors so we can pull up, pull in, close it, and be in our own little world. And we don't build relationships with each other. Why? Because relationships take time. We don't connect with each other. We don't grow closer together, and it hurts us. It hurts us as individuals. It hurts us as a church. It hurts us as a society. We don't have those relationships. Because it's within those relationships we begin to learn about needs. We begin to learn about who people are and what they're interested in, what they're important, and when they have needs that we can then serve each other. And as we learn about needs, then we can give, and we can learn that, oh, that's why you gave me an abundance of this resource, God, to pour it out here, to be life-giving to this individual and help them out. And the thing is, the relationships don't even have to be deep in order to be life-giving. First Wednesday of each month, we hand out food here. Most of the people we run into, is the extent of the relationship for most of us is saying hi to them or God bless as we see an open window or we're able to call through a door or whatever. That's the extent of the relationship that we have, and yet it still is life-giving. But in the midst of this, we continue to pray that God would open their eyes to realize that it's not just about food, but that we are actually ultimately wanting to share his love. That ultimately we'd be able to build a deeper relationship that they can grow closer to God. But what I found in our society, and this is something, you know, self-confession time, that for most of us, it's easier to serve someone than it is to allow them to serve us. And that sometimes our ultimate act of service can be that we allow someone to do for us and allow God to work in them and through them to be a blessing as well. I remember when I was in college and we were in chapel and our chapel speaker spoke on this. And in the midst of it, he had this song, and I'd never heard it before. But it was a song that, yeah, even after hearing it just that one time, has stuck with me and has impacted my life, because I'm one of those that grew up with do for others and do for others and do for others and don't ever admit that you have a need and don't let others do for you. But he had this song, and the song goes like this. It says, "Brother, let me be your servant. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too." Okay? Yeah, we want to serve. We want to do that. But God says, hey, sometimes it's about stepping back and letting others have the blessing as well, of being used and being able to be that outpouring into your life too. Because as we do this, as we share with each other, and as we are able to bless each other, or God is able to bless each other through us, that brings about unity. That brings about community. See, one of the things that I remember growing up is in our neighborhoods. I remember those days when mom would go, we'd be making cookies or something, and mom would go, oh man, we're short on sugar. Hey, Tim, can you run next door and see if our neighbor has a cup of sugar? How many of you remember those days? And there'd be another day where they would send a child over, they'd come over, hey, I'm short a couple of eggs. Right? You have any, oh yeah, we got some eggs, we can help out with that. And what did that do? That brought unity, that brought community together. Why? Because we were helping each other out and we were realizing that we are all interconnected and we can do these things for each other. Most of us don't even know our neighbors' names. I won't judge that, but in America, most of us don't even know our neighbors' names. Let alone be willing to do that. And I'll be the first to admit, I'm not. Most of my life, I haven't been good at that. But this last summer is interesting because even during COVID, God started kind of convicting us of that. And so we started doing this with our neighbors, and we'd take them stuff and met neighbors next door. They're from Hawaii. They were a kick. They were fun. We took them over some fruit that we got at the food pantry. They were excited about it. Next thing we know, they're knocking on our door going, hey, we did Hawaiian barbecue. You want some? Oh, no, no, no. No, it was good. Okay? But then we started building a relationship and started sharing these things with each other like that. Some of you are going, hey, we get along well. And got to know them more. But it's amazing how that happens just by sharing with each other. Not closing ourselves off. But we grow together and it brings that unity. And unfortunately, you know, we talk a lot in the church about we need unity, we need to come together, we need unity, we're a family, we're a body. But unfortunately, many of us don't even make the time to get to know each other right here. We don't even make the time to know each other in this body. And about the extent of what we know about each other is, well, I think I see him every once in a while on a Sunday morning. And if we want to have unity within the body, if we want to have unity within the body world, why, we've got to make the time to get to know each other. To build relationship, to serve each other, to come together. And as we do these things, as we make time for God, as we make time for ourselves, as we make time for others, as God leads us, as God enables us, then we will find ourselves becoming godly stewards of our time. Of our time. And we'll see amazing things happen as it's not that God will give us more time, because there's still only 24 hours in a day. But we will see the things that we are investing our time in are becoming more and more the things of value and the things that make a difference and the things that bring honor to God and the things that not only fulfill others but fulfill us and help us to be the people God created us to be. In Matthew 21, verses 28 to 31, Jesus tells a parable. He's been asked what, you know, kind of what the kingdom of God is like. And he says it's like a man, and he has two sons. And he goes to his first son, and he says, son, I want you to go out and work in the field today. And the son says, yeah, dad, I'd be happy to. But then he doesn't go. I don't know, maybe Xbox or something caught his attention, and he started playing a game or something like that. And he ends up not going. He goes to his second son and says, son, I'd like you to go out in the field and to work. And the son says, no, Dad, I can't even believe you would ask me. Don't we have servants for that kind of thing, Dad? Why would you ask me to go out in the field? I'm busy. I got all this stuff going on. But it says, but then later on, it says he repented, or he had a change of heart, and he decided to go. And so he goes out and works. And Jesus looks at the crowd around him and he says, which one did the will of his father? And the answer is, it's the one who made the time to obey. It wasn't about the words, it was about the action. And it's really easy in our lives when we start talking about stewardship to say, yeah, I need to do that. Yeah, I should do that. Yeah, you know. But oftentimes what happens is we start going, well, yeah, I'll do that when I get around to it, right? When I have more time, when I get around to it. Well, I've got good news for you today. On your way out of service today, I want you each to pick up a round to it. We've got round to it for each of you today to take home with you. So that instead of saying, when I get around to it, you've got around to it. Which means what? That we now get to live in what God calls, I want each of you to live in today. In this moment, I will be obedient to God. Today, I can be obedient. Today, I can follow him. Why? Because I got around to it. And so we've got those outside. Don't leave without yours. And I'd encourage you to take it and put it in a place where you can see it, use it to remind you. Use it to remind you to be a godly steward of your time. Make time for God. Make time for yourself. Make time for others. As God leads you, as God resources you, as God enables you, so that you can be that conduit, God's irrigation system, to bring life and health and beauty to the people and the world around you, as he sources you and as he enables you. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for being with us. We thank you for your love and your grace. We thank you, God, that your desire is that we would have the best life possible. And so you pour into us. You source us from yourself with everything we need. And God, as we realize, as we have found you, so often, you give abundantly to us, more than what we need. And so, God, we pray that you would help us to be those conduits, that you'd help us to be that irrigation to pour out into others as you lead us, as you guide us, as you enable us, to help bring your life and your resources to them, that their lives would be enhanced as well, that people that are not in relationship with you would be drawn into relationship with you, that people that are in relationship with you would grow in relationship with you, that we would be sourced and grow as well, that your body may be healthy and thrive as each part of it rejoices and mourns and lives together according to your plan and your purpose, that you may be honored and glorified. For we do love you and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, I invite the worship team to come back up as we continue to worship and to celebrate God, as we continue to seek him. And I'd encourage you to take this time and say, okay, God, how am I doing? You've called me to be a godly steward. That's part of being the person that you created me to be. In particular today, you've called me to be a godly steward of my time. How am I investing? How am I using? How am I spending my time? Is it truly on the things that enhance my life and enhance the lives of the people around me? Is it truly in a way that honors you and glorifies you? Am I being who you've called me and created me to be? And if you pray that and God says, yeah, you're right, you're doing exactly what I want you to do at this point in time, celebrate that. Say thank you, God, because it's only by his grace and by his presence and his work in your life that you're at that place. But if as you seek him, you talk to him, he says, nah, we got some work to do. Maybe there's some leaks. Maybe there's some kinks in the hose. Maybe there's some, maybe the first thing is he's saying, you're not connected. And you need to receive my forgiveness and start a relationship with me so we can be connected, so I can start sourcing you. Maybe saying you're connected, but you're trying to keep it all to yourself and you think it's all about you. And you need to start looking outside of yourself to where, how can you be a blessing to others? So this can flow through, and rather than bringing death and grossness into your life, it can become a source of life to you and the people around you. Whatever it may be, I encourage you to seek him and say, okay, what needs to happen, God? What's the next step in my life that I can be the person you created me to be? Where do we need to go from here? God is faithful. He will tell you, he will show you, and he will help you take those steps if you'll just let him. Let's stand together. And in this time, if you want to come forward and you want to pray up at the altars, you're welcome to come. If you want to pray right where you're at, you're welcome to do that as well. If you want to grab someone beside you and say, hey, would you pray with me? You don't even have to tell them what they're praying about. Just say, hey, would you pray with me? We're the body. We're here to help each other, encourage each other, lift each other up, support each other. Whatever it may be, let's take this time, because the reality is that when we get in touch with God and we allow him to work within us, then in his time, he creates us to be exactly who he created us to be. He recreates us. So let's seek him. If you want to come, come as we sing. But let's keep our focus on him. What is your next step in growing with him? God, that is the prayer of our heart. You'd help us to seek you and to follow you, to love you and to serve you, to allow you to work in and through us, that every aspect of our lives would bring honor and glory to you. And God, as we are focusing over these weeks, that God, you would create in us and recreate in us, that we would be godly stewards in every area of our lives, that as you pour your resources, you pour your life, as you pour your love into us, that then you would be able to use us and lead us and guide us and how to allow that to flow through us. That not only would we have the best life possible, but could we contribute to those around us, that they could have the best life possible as well, just as you created us for. And God, we pray that you would help us to get connected and stay connected to you, that you would source us in everything. We pray, God, you'd help us to continue to allow you to work in our lives and through our lives to mold us and repair us and help us and build us up and shape us to be who you created us to be, to live the lives you created us to live. And God, we thank you so much. You've been at work in our lives, and you've been hearing us. You've been answering prayers. It's making a difference, and we are so thankful, God. You've been touching and healing. Many are here today who you've touched and healed, and just even in this last week. You're continuing to provide resources that are needed in life. Food, shelter, clothing, money for bills, whatever it may be. You've been giving guidance and direction. You've been filling us with your hope and your peace and even your joy, your strength, your love. We're so thankful for all this, God. And God, we're thankful that you continue to listen to us and you continue to answer, you continue to respond, you continue to take care of us. And God, we continue to lift up those who are dealing with physical issues and pray that you would touch them and bring healing. You'd give them your strength and draw them to you. We lift up, God, those who are dealing with issues with resources, money, and food, shelter, clothing, whatever it may be, God. Would you provide for them? God, we continue to lift up those who are dealing with mental issues, and whether it's depression or anxiety or stress or so many other things that are going on. And we pray, God, that you would touch them right where they're at and help them. God, there's many around us who are dealing with loneliness. Even in the midst of this crowd, they're still lonely. And God, there's so many fears and worries and different things in our lives that keep pouring in on us. There's so much confusion and chaos in our lives and in the world around us. It's so easy to just get down. And so God, in the midst of it all, we just pray that you would be with us, that you would lift us up, that you would meet us at our point of need and continue to work in us and through us. And that, God, you would help us as a body to reach out to each other, to love each other, to encourage each other. Would you show us, God, how you want to work within us and through us to be part of the solution? Whether it's people in our body or people around the world, wherever they may be, show us how we can be part of that solution. How we can share your hope and your peace and your life in the world around us, to make a positive difference for you, for your kingdom, that you may be honored and glorified in and through us. And God, we look forward to what you're going to do. And God, this morning we want to join together with our brothers and sisters all around the world as we've been called to by our denominational leaders. And we pray, God, for a fresh filling of your Spirit, filling us to overflowing, so that we may live in our world today as you have called us to live. For God, we do love you and we praise you. You are so worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, God is good. He continues to work within us and through us. And what we find is that as he works and as he moves and we are blessed by him, that it's just natural for us to turn around and bless back, to give him praise. And so this morning we just want to close out our time here by saying, God, we want to bless you. We want to celebrate you. We have 10,000 reasons and beyond to lift up your name and to give you glory. So let's bring that to him and give him the glory and the honor today. Amen. Amen.
soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. When on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near, my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
Forevermore!
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Lord, I'll worship Your holy name. Lord, I'll worship Your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name.
Amen. Well, may you continue to worship Him as you see His hand at work in and through you throughout the days of the week and the rest of your life. And may we open ourselves up to be used by God, to be blessed by Him, to be a blessing to others. And don't forget, as you head out, pick up your round to it. We don't want anyone to miss out on getting around to it, okay? And allow God to work it in through you. Hope you have a great week, and God bless.